Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Judaism, A Very Short Introduction, 2nd Edition, by Normon Solomon, narrated by Jesse Einstein.
Hath not a Jew eyes? Hath not a Jew hands, organs, dimensions, sense, affections, passions? Fed with the same food, hurt with the same weapons, subject to the same diseases, healed by the same means, warmed and cooled by the same winter and summer, as a Christian is? If you prick us, do we not bleed? William Shakespeare, The Merchant of Venice, Act 3, Scene 1, Verse 63. Introduction. Finding the Right Words. You are reading a book written in the English language. The English language is not neutral. It evolved in a Christian civilization. It comes ready loaded with a cargo of Christian concepts and assumptions. As Christianity was born out of a conflict within first century Judaism and defined itself as against Judaism, it is difficult from within a Christian culture and language to look at Judaism with the innocence you might look at, say, Shinto or Buddhism. Just think of some of the offensive overtones which have been carried in English by the simple word Jew. If you find yourself asking questions like, "What do Jews believe about Jesus?" or "What is more important in Judaism, faith or works?" you have got off on the wrong footing. You are approaching Judaism with cultural baggage imported from Christianity. You will find answers to some questions of this kind in this book, but they will not help you to comprehend Judaism as Judaism understands itself, from within. Judaism simply does not define itself around Jesus, nor does it assume that faith and works are opposing concepts. So let us make a fresh start and try to discover what it's like to be a Jew, how Judaism looks from within. Here is a list of key terms drawn up by a class of Christian students who were trying to identify the terms that might be useful to explain to others what it was like to be a Christian. God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Resurrection. Salvation. Baptism. Forgiveness. Crucifixion. Conversion. Confirmation. Ascension. Justification. Scriptures. Faith. Love. Nativity. Holy Communion. Prayer. Trust. Fellowship. Born again. Obedience. Eternal life. Discipleship. The next list was drawn up by a religious Jew who wanted to explain his faith to a group of Christians. God. Personal historical protean relationship. Torah. The way, instruction, teaching, not law. Mitzvah. Commandment, the practical unit of Torah, a good deed. Avira, transgression, sin. Free will. Teshuvah, penitence, returning to God. Tefillah, prayer. Tzedakah, fairness, correctness, charity. Chesed, love, compassion, kindness. Yetzer tov, good impulse, the innate psychological tendency to do good, contrasted with yetzer hara, the impulse to do evil. The cause and the remedy for unfaithfulness to God lie within the individual. Israel, people, land, covenant. Some of the terms, God, Torah, Israel, are familiar enough to English-speaking Christians, but the compiler of the list evidently thought they should be glossed, because despite the familiarity of the words, they might be misunderstood. Rather, a lot of the words, however, are Hebrew. Though they are everyday Hebrew words, easy words in that language, it is very difficult to formulate their meaning in English. As it happens, all of the words in the Christian list, except the Christological group, Son, Crucifixion, Ascension, and Nativity, might well be used in a Jewish conversation, but they would carry different nuances and a different weight within the system. It is precisely words such as covenant, salvation, and scripture, widely used in both faith traditions, that cause the most confusion. Their use overlaps, but does not entirely coincide. Sometimes the two religions are divided rather than united by a common language. Do not worry that the Hebrew words sound as if they might be hard to remember or to understand. They will be explained again whenever necessary. But the best way to pick them up is in context, in reading this book or others, or in your conversations with Jews who use them naturally. It is just like learning a language. In fact, it is learning a language, the natural language of Judaism. No religion is an abstraction. Its adherents may claim that God inspired it, or even that he dictated its texts, and that it is eternally valid. But the texts have to be interpreted by people and implemented in the lives of people, and the story which will unfold on the pages ahead is the story of how Jews have lived with their texts for the past 2,000 years. Our story has four dramatis personae: God, the Torah, the people of Israel, and the surrounding world. It is a story in which relationships are important, and the particular, Israel, is in constant interaction with the universal, humanity as a whole, in the shape of the surrounding culture. There are challenges and responses, tensions and resolutions, tragedies and joys. Judaism is the religion of the Jews, obvious. But who are the Jews? That will be the theme of chapter 1. For the moment, we will regard as Jews all members of those groups today who define themselves as Jews in positive relation to the traditions formulated by the rabbis of the Talmud. You can find out about the Talmud in chapter 3. This definition excludes the religion of the Old Testament, still presented as Judaism in reactionary theological colleges. The world of the rabbis is grounded in that of the Hebrew scriptures on which it rests its authority. But as we shall see, it is far from a literal reading of the text. Likewise, the definition excludes other Jewish sects, which flourished in the first century. For instance, Essenes, Sadducees, Samaritans, and Jewish Christians, though we will meet some of these groups in chapter 2 when we tell the story of how Judaism and Christianity, which were at first one religion, split apart. We will focus on religion. Religion cannot be divorced from society, or from history, or from the emotional experiences and intellectual insights of its adherents. Therefore, some information about Jewish society and history will be included. And we will make our own choice amongst the great schools of Jewish historiography, who tell the same story so differently from one another. There is, for instance, the lachrymose school, to whom Jewish history is a veil of tears and suffering and martyrdom as one persecution followed another. This has been with us since Ephraim of Bonn in the 12th century composed his famous martyrology in the wake of the massacres of Jews in the Rhineland, England, and France which accompanied the Second Crusade. Then there is the Jerusalem school, Ben Zion Dinur, in whose eyes all Jewish history relates to the land of Israel. And at the opposite pole, the great historian, Simon Dubnow, who stressed the positive achievement of diaspora Judaism. And there are the traditional theologians, who, in true biblical style, see history as the narration of the people's sinfulness and penitence, and God's punishment and reward, or who divide history into great preordained cycles, culminating with the arrival of the Messiah. Sharira Gaon, in 10th century Babylonia, set the pattern for those to whom history meant tracing authentic tradition back to Moses. Franz Rosenzweig, in 20th century Germany, seems to deny that history is significant at all. We see God in each ethical action, but not in the finished whole, in history, for why would we need a God if history were divine? For us, however, the emphasis will lie with the creative history of Judaism. The suffering and the persecutions and the forced migrations cannot be denied. But amazingly, throughout the centuries, the spirit has flourished with a still unending procession of poets and saints, of philosophers and of Bible commentators, of grammarians and Talmudists, of lawyers and satirists, and pastors and schoolmen, of unsung women and men of humble faith. Chapter 1. Who are the Jews? Is the tomato a fruit or a vegetable? To the botanist, it is undoubtedly a fruit. To the chef, a vegetable. But what would the tomato itself say? If it thought about the matter at all, it would probably have the same sort of identity crisis Jews are apt to get when people try to straitjacket them as a race, an ethnic group, or a religion. Neither tomatoes nor Jews are particularly complicated or obscure when left to themselves, but they also don't fit neatly into the handy categories such as fruit or vegetable or nation or religion, which are so useful for pigeonholing other foods and people. How would you recognize a Jew if you bumped into him or her in the street? Since there are black as well as white Jews, Oriental as well as Occidental, converts as well as natives, atheist and agnostic, as well as many types of religious Jews, is there any way to describe them collectively? How many of them are there? Where do they live? Who the Jews used to be? The question of Jewish identity is surprisingly new. Nobody in medieval Christendom, for instance, thought there was a problem. They knew who the Jews were. The Jews were a special people, the chosen people, as it says in the Bible, chosen by God to be the vehicle of His revelation. But they had rejected Jesus, and therefore were accursed and condemned to lowly status until, in the fullness of time, they would recognize Jesus. By the late Middle Ages, the Christian prophecy had fulfilled itself. Christians, by the exercise of political power, had actually brought the Jews to the lowly social state they had prophesied for them. Jews were confined to ghettos, made to wear distinctive clothing, excluded from guilds and professions and the ownership of land, vilified from the pulpit as killers of Christ, accused of poisoning wells during the Black Death, of desecrating the host, of murdering Christian children to use their blood for the Passover, the so-called blood libel, and of almost every villainy that a warped mind could project on an alien group. It is revealing and rather shocking to look at the way Jews have been portrayed in Christian religious art, especially in the West. Prior to the 12th century, They have no physical features to distinguish them from other people. Then, suddenly, there is a change, and Europe's Jews acquire hooked noses, webbed feet, and other aspects of what was thought to be the physiognomy of the devil. Even in the 20th century, the folk belief persists in parts of Europe that Jews have horns. But of course, it was not the Jews who mysteriously changed their appearance in the 12th century and changed back again in the modern period, but Christian iconography, which articulated the myth of Jewish alliance with the devil. The stereotypes generated within medieval Christendom persisted even when the system collapsed under the impact of the Enlightenment. Even a champion of the Enlightenment, such as Voltaire, regarded the Jews as a reprobate and inferior race. In place of the theological anti-Judaism of the Church, there came into being a racial anti-Semitism, which culminated in the Nazi Endlösung, or Final Solution, the project of humiliating and physically exterminating the Jewish race. The Nazis, however, had a problem. By 1933, it was transparently obvious that Jews did not have tails, horns, or any other gross features to distinguish them from other Germans, or Poles, or whatever. So whilst Goebbels and his propaganda machine revived the medieval caricatures for publication in Der Stürmer, the reality of Jewish normality was so far from the fantasy of Jewish racial distinctiveness that the Nuremberg laws had to define Jews lamely as anyone who had at least one Jewish great-grandparent, that is, 12.5% of Jewish blood. Ominously, the Nazis based their early anti-Jewish laws, including boycott, segregation, and distinctive clothing, on those of Pope Innocent III's Fourth Lateran Council of 1215. A major aim of such legislation was to isolate Jews by making them look different from other people, despite the fact that nature had inconveniently fashioned them much the same as everyone else. How the Jews used to think of themselves. For as long as the surrounding cultures, Christian or Muslim, persisted in defining Jews as a people apart and setting up laws to ensure this separateness, Jews internalized their social condition and themselves interpreted it in the old biblical terms. They saw themselves as God's chosen people, a nation in exile from its land. They agreed with their oppressors that they were exiled on account of their sins. However, the conclusions they based on this were different from those of the Christians and Muslims. Whereas Christians and, to a lesser extent, Muslims, thought God's punishment of the Jews was a rejection and an abandonment, the Jews themselves understood it as a confirmation of their special, chosen status, for those whom he loves does the Lord chastise. Proverbs 3:12. The nations amongst whom they were exiled were like the unclean idolaters of old, whose blandishments and evil influence must at all costs be resisted, until such time as God, in his infinite mercy, chose to redeem and vindicate his people. So throughout the Middle Ages, and much later, wherever medieval attitudes and social structures persisted, Jews had no identity problem. Their own traditions and the surrounding cultures reinforced one another in drawing sharp lines to set Jews apart from their geographical neighbors. There was always, of course, a fuzzy margin, but it was a small one, easily decided by traditional rules. What, for instance, was the status of the child of Jewish parents who had perhaps been captured by an enemy, brought up as a Christian, and then returned to the Jewish fold? Or if, as may have happened not infrequently, a Jewish woman was raped by a Christian soldier or overlord, what was the status of her child? The rule, dating back at least to Roman times, was clear. The child of a Jewish mother was Jewish, and the child of a Jewish father by a non-Jewish woman was not Jewish unless and until formally converted. This is still the rule amongst most Jewish groups, though recently, under the influence of the trend towards gender equality, Reform congregations in the USA have decided that if either parent is Jewish, the child has full rights in the Jewish community without the need for formal conversion. Who the Jews think they are now? In his work on Jewish identity, Michael Meyer, who is professor of Jewish history at the Hebrew Union College Jewish Institute of Religion in Cincinnati, draws on the research of the sociologist Eric H. Erickson for his understanding of identity as those totalities of characteristics which individuals believe to constitute themselves. Individual identity is built upon pre-adult identifications with persons close to the child, with their values and behavior patterns. As the individual becomes an adult, these identifications must be integrated not only with one another, but with the norms of the society in which the individual will play a role. This latter process represents identity formation. Integration with the norms of the society in which the individual will play a role posed no great problem to the ghetto Jew. The norms and values of the limited society of which he felt himself a part, namely Jewish society, did not conflict seriously with the norms and values he had acquired from the family that nurtured him. Family, community, and alienation from what lay beyond combined to circumscribe a clear identity. However, as Jews gradually gained civil rights in Europe and America and felt themselves citizens of the new nations or even of the whole world, many of them were exposed to radically different norms and values from those of their childhood. Identity became less clear, less secure. Meyer claims that three factors contributed to the formation of contemporary Jewish identity, namely the Enlightenment, anti-Semitism, and the rise of the State of Israel. Let's see how these factors have operated. The process of enlightenment, through which Jews, as they were released from the restrictions of ghetto life, themselves became attuned to modern culture, meant that it became necessary to justify their behavior by reason, the common basis of discourse, rather than by appeal to any authority, such as that of special revelation. It also meant that public law should treat all people equally. This brought new civil rights to Jews, but at the same time denied their self-understanding as a special people. Perhaps no one put this more sharply than Count Clermont-Tonnerre, arguing before the National Assembly of the French Revolutionary Government in 1789 for full citizenship of Jews. One must refuse everything to the Jews as a nation, but one must give them everything as individuals. They must become citizens. Jews, that is, were to be granted full rights as French citizens. But in return, they had to abandon their collective distinctiveness and autonomy. Individual choice was to replace traditional communal authority, and religion would be a private matter. Though many Jews welcomed this change, which quickly spread through Western and parts of Central Europe, some of the traditionalists opposed it vehemently, sensing a threat to established community authority and to traditional Jewish belief and practice. As Peter Berger has argued, heresy became the common condition in modernity once the plausibility structure of traditional beliefs was called into question and individual choice replaced the unquestioned acceptance of community authority. At this point in the book, there is a picture with the caption describing it: "Few leaders contributed more to implementing equal rights in Europe than Napoleon Bonaparte. In 1807, he convened a Sanhedrin of Jewish notables to authorize the commitments he expected as a basis for full citizenship. Antisemitism, according to Meyer, has had an ambiguous effect on Jewish identity. On the one hand, rejection by the outside world has led to the reaffirmation of Jewish identity. Movements of religious renewal have often flourished at times of discrimination or persecution, as Enlightenment ideals of reason and universality have lost their attractiveness. The Damascus affair of 1840, when the Jews of that city were accused of ritual murder and threatened with mass execution, stirred protest meetings amongst Jews as far away as the USA, provoked the intervention of Moses Montefiore of England and Adolphe Cremieux of France, and generally rallied Jews to an overall sense of purpose. The Mortara affair of 1858, when a Jewish child was secretly baptized by a Christian domestic and abducted to a monastery, led directly to the formation in 1859 of the Board of Delegates of American Israelites, and in 1860 of the French Alliance Israelite Universelle, which, like the Board of Deputies of British Jews set up in 1760 at the accession of George III, fostered a sense of Jewish solidarity whilst serving the primary cause of the defense of Jewish rights. On the other hand, antisemitism has led Jews to turn away from identification with the Jewish community and to seek to lose or conceal their Jewish identity by merging with the surrounding culture. When Jews perceive that they are devalued by non-Jews, they may feel devalued in their own eyes, somehow internalizing the prejudice against them and falling prey to self-hatred. People change their names, appearance, or habits to merge as far as possible with the surroundings, so that their Jewishness is not immediately apparent. In the words of Michael Meyer, "Anti-Semitic prejudice produces a heightened Jewish self-consciousness in the presence of Gentiles, which results in the endeavor to keep Jewishness as invisible as possible for as long as possible to the eye of the untrustworthy outsider whose favor is sought." Karl Marx's early, 1844, essay, On the Jewish Question, is a fascinating example of an intellectual form of Jewish self-hatred. He argues that Judaism is neither religion nor peoplehood, but the desire for gain, totally ignoring the vast Jewish proletariat of Central and Eastern Europe. He equates Jews, and the Christians whose religion derives from them, with the enemy, namely, bourgeois capitalism. Clearly, he is fleeing his own Jewish identity. He was baptized at the age of 6, but was descended from rabbis on both sides of the family, assimilating to the cultural milieu of the anti-Semitic Feuerbach, whose perverse definition of Judaism he has adopted, and finding refuge from Jewish particularism in socialist universalism. Amongst Marx's close associates was Moses Hess, slightly older than Marx, and a notable socialist philosopher in his own right. In an essay written early in his career, he expressed an attitude towards Judaism similar to that of Feuerbach and Marx. Later, he came to terms with his Jewish identity, which he reaffirmed not in religious terms, but in national terms, in his seminal work, Rome and Jerusalem. Hess, that is, had responded to the third determinant of Jewish identity in modern times, the concept of the return to Zion. The paradox of Zionism, the term was coined only in 1892, lies in its twin origins, religious and secular. In the religious sense, the return to Zion is as old as God's promise to Abraham of the land in which he dwelled, and it has been reinforced throughout the ages through scripture, prayer, and the pious desire to fulfill God's command.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.